Stay standing. All right. Today, repeat after me. Today, I'm going to encounter the Prince of Peace. I'm going to leave here with more peace than I came. I thank you, Father, for an impartation of a greater understanding of how to receive peace and how to walk in peace and how to reign in peace. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. All right, give God a hand clap. Wow, that was amazing. As you guys know, that's my favoritist, is just to be in his presence. Aye, aye. So we've been talking a lot about, and this month has been about restoration and God bringing restoration to different areas of our life. And one of the things I believe is so important is that we understand who we are. And so that he's, you know, bringing restoration to identity, so that we understand who we are and whose we are. So I kind of launched the series off talking about identity. If you weren't here and you haven't heard the message, I suggest you go online, and that's why we videotape these. You can watch them online, or you can listen to them on audio as well. And then Pastor Matthew brought in, like, what is the prophetic actually for, and the importance of how we can speak into people's destinies, and how God wants to even use prophecy to help establish family and identity. Isn't that amazing? And it was such a powerful time. And then, you know, Max ministered last week and just brought even more of how God wants to use us to bring restoration to the body of Christ. And that's an important thing for us here at the Well. But also, I think it's on God's heart, is that we reproduce ourselves. You know, Matthew said that, you know, during the offering, and I think about it a lot. It's actually been in my heart even more recently. It's like, what am I doing with what God has given me? You know, what do I do from, it's not just, this is such a small part. I mean, trust me, this is such a small part of what it is that we do to help steward what God is wanting to do in this move, I believe, throughout this region. But am I doing enough with what God has given me? Is every day significant? And it is it not? Because there's one thing that we'll never get back, and that's time. And so I actually led part of our team through a prayer of repentance in the side room of just, hey, if we've not taken things that God has given us seriously, then I'm sorry, and we repent for that. Because there's a lot of gifts, there's so much. Yeah. You know, let me just, it's nothing to do with what I'm going to talk about, but let me get on my soapbox for a moment. Because there's so much that we have here in the United States that we're just so blessed. It used to be that if you had one iPad, that was amazing. Now people have multiple iPads in their family. I mean, I have a 4-year-old granddaughter who sits there with an iPad and knows how to move it around probably better than I do. And I'm like, this is crazy. She's 4 years old and she's got her own iPad, with her own little iPad case. And so we have all of this stuff, and that's fine. I'm not mocking. There's nothing wrong with that. But I think that we have a tendency, though, that we have surplus, that things get kind of tossed aside. It's like, well, I've got how many pairs of black pants? I'm like, boom, 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 boom. You know what I'm saying? And so do we do that with what God has given us, with the gifts, the qualities, the value that God has placed on us? You know, he placed a value on you. He placed a value on me. And do I really recognize the value that he has placed on me? And that he really wants to walk with me. He desires to walk with me. He desires to walk with you. He desires to have this intimate relationship. And so I just got to thinking, God, am I really, I mean, at the end of the day, when I'm sitting there on that Bema seat of judgment, and I'm not being judged whether I'm going to go to heaven or hell, but I'm going to be judged for whether or not I did what I was supposed to do with the things that he gave me. When the fire comes, come on, because this is going to happen. We live right here, don't we? We live for here. We live for today. And sometimes we may make goals that are 5-year goals. Sometimes we'll make a 10-year goal. I mean, those of us who are really visionaries, we might go out 20 years, but we're supposed to be living for all of eternity. So what we do today doesn't affect just tomorrow, it affects your eternity. What I deposit into your life doesn't just affect you today, it should affect you and the people around you for all of eternity, right? So when I'm speaking to you, I'm not just speaking to you, I'm speaking to you and to the person that you're going to speak to, the person that that person is going to speak to, on and on and on and on for all of eternity. And so when you start to... it was just a couple weeks ago. I was on the floor because you have moments with God that you're just like, oh, he's the best thing in the world. And you have other moments where you're just kind of going through life. I mean, let's just be real. And I was having one of those moments where things were, you know, going good. And yet I was so busy. And I was like, guys, help me not to say I'm too busy, because there's never such a thing as being too busy. You can find time. You can find time. And so, anyways, I'm on the floor on my knees during worship, and I cried out to God, and I said, God, don't let go of me. Don't ever let go. That if it seems like sometimes I'm not holding on to you as tightly as I do at other seasons, don't ever let go. And I meant it with all of my heart, and I could feel him pulling me close. And it was like to say, and I know the scripture, I'll never leave you nor I'll never forsake you, but there's something about feeling the arms of Jesus that says, oh no, I'm never going to let you go. And just feel him pull you in and just surround you with his love. Because really, guys, he's all we have. Amen? And he makes life better. He just makes life better. So when I started thinking about this whole month of restoration and want to talk about inheritance, and I thought, wow, there's so much I could talk about with inheritance. There's financial blessing. There's prosperity of our soul. There's healing. There's our salvation. That's the greatest inheritance of all. And we could go on and on with everything that we get to inherit as being children of God. I thought, there's one thing that we get to inherit that I believe helps us and sustains us in life more than any other thing, and that's peace. I believe that we inherit the Prince of Peace, that we inherit peace himself, and if we could walk in that peace, if we can master that, then there's no storm that we can't go through, because it's not the absence of storms that God promised us. It's that he would be with us in the midst of them. Amen? So I'm going to talk to you a little bit. Turn with me to Philippians 4. I wrote this down. This is so good. Understanding the anointing God has placed in and on our life is important, and it's a part of our inheritance, because the anointing can quickly empower us and take us places where our character may not be able to keep us. Let me say that again. It's important that we understand the anointing, but I think that it's more important that we understand how our character is developed through the process of walking with God, which is why I wanted to focus on peace, because of the fact that the anointing can quickly empower us and take us places where our character may not be able to keep us. God isn't nearly as interested in what we do as he is in who we are. It's God's mercy to withhold some of his blessings from us, because if we're not ready to receive them, they'll only crush us. Yeah. Amen? Amen? So Philippians 4, starting in verse 6, says this: be anxious for nothing. And that word nothing means for nothing and for no one. So be anxious for nothing and for no one, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Now, I looked up in the Greek what that word guard means, and it means literally to protect by a military guard. That's the kind of peace that you'll have. That it literally will guard you. Have you ever tried? I mean, I don't know how many of you ever been over by the White House, but I mean, you're not going to get into the White House. Good luck. Because there's a military that's guarding that you can't even see. And that's the cool thing about operating out of a peace that you can't even see. You can't even see how God is guarding your heart against anything else while you're going through a circumstance, because there's a military force that's been set up to surround your heart and to guard and protect it. That's the kind of peace that God wants to give us. That's the only peace that he can give. It comes from him. John 14, 27. I'm going to read it out of the Amplified, so if you look up there, you're going to get kind of confused, but I'm going to need my friend. This is my friend. This is your friend, too. We're going to tell you about my friend. What did Jesus say in John 14, 27? He said, "Peace I leave with you. This is my Lamb of Peace." He said, "Peace I leave with you. My perfect peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Do not let your heart be troubled, nor let it be afraid. Let my perfect peace calm you in every circumstance and give you courage and strength for every challenge." Now, hi, buddy. So, it kind of reminds me of Gabe. I have two little dogs, and they're like, one is a Maltipom, and the other one is a Shorkie, and Gabe's got the biggest attitude of all of them, and he's the Maltipom, and he's definitely anxious. He needs the Prince of Peace. He's always like the little anxiety ball, and then we have Moses, who's just chill. He's Mr. Chill. He's the one member I told some of you about that there's things that he can do, but he can only do it if you're there to encourage him. And I said, it's kind of like how the Holy Spirit is. You know, he's there with us, and we just need to acknowledge his presence. And so he can jump up on my bed. I have a high bed. It has like a ledge where he can jump on the ledge and then jump up onto the bed. But he won't do it unless I stand behind him. He will leap. Up in the air, 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 up in the air. Drives me crazy. I'm like, oh my gosh. And so I go behind and go, come on, you can do it. I don't touch him. And he goes right up. Isn't that crazy? Moses. Anyway, keep my peace. So the reason why I'm holding him, this will become more clear in just a moment. going back to my childhood. Come on, you guys all had one of these. You either had a blankie or something, and I had a blankie. And so this is my peace. And so it's interesting is that God says, I leave you with peace. And most of us set it down. And we never really walk in the peace that he said, I give you. He said, I give you my peace. The peace that he had, knowing that he was going to go to the cross. The peace he had, knowing that the people that he was walking with actually turned their back on him and walked away. The same peace that he had when somebody who was dipping bread with him, having, you know, breaking bread together, was the same one that was going to come, and he was going to be the betrayer that was going to send him to the cross. Now, all these things had to happen, but he had peace during that whole time. He says, that's the peace I leave with you. The same peace that when he said, oh, Father, why have you forsaken me? Where have you gone? That same peace. The same peace. He felt the same things that we feel. He went through a lot of trials, guys, you know. It wasn't like this little cakewalk that he had, that he was Jesus Christ. He was the Messiah and everything was perfect. He cried tears of blood. He went through hardships. He went through hard times, many trials and sufferings. And yet he did it with peace. And he said, that's the kind of peace I leave with you, this peace. So we should keep our peace. He gave it to us. So now turn with me to Matthew 14. You know, where it says, do not let your heart be troubled, nor let it be afraid. That word troubled is the same, that word troubled in the Greek means not to be troubled by tos and fros. In other words, not to be tossed to and fro. It's the movement that is in your life. It's transition. It's change. Don't be troubled when there's movement in your life. Don't be troubled when things look like they're going to and fro. That's what that word troubled means, Matthew 14:22. Immediately, Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side. And while he sent the multitudes away, and when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. Now when evening had came, he was alone there. But the boat was now in the middle of the sea, tossed by the waves, for the wind was contrary. Now in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "Is it a ghost?" And they cried out for fear. So that same word, troubled, is the same word that we find in John 14. So I started thinking about, interesting, that Jesus is saying, don't be troubled. Remember the peace that I'm leaving with you, that I'm giving you. Don't be troubled by the boat of life. So they're in this boat represents life, and the wind and the waves are taking them to and fro. And he's saying, don't be troubled. So here's the interesting thing about this, is that we look at this and we think, oh, they're like, oh my gosh, these winds and the waves and all these things are happening, and Jesus is coming, and they're freaking out because he's walking on the water, and they think they're gonna capsize, and all this stuff is going to happen. And he's like, no, don't be troubled. These guys were experienced fishermen. Do you think that they were used to storms? Yeah, they were used to storms. They weren't like, oh my gosh, there's winds and there's waves, there's a storm. This is what they did. They were out in a boat in storms many times. Right. Theologians say that they were probably in that boat for 9 hours. Jesus cried out in the 9th hour. 9 hours they were in that boat. One of the things that robs us of peace is fatigue, is when you just get tired. They've been out in that boat for 9 hours. And when you get tired and peace tries to leave, you start to do things that don't make sense. They freaked out. And he said, don't be troubled. Sometimes things happen in life. Sometimes you're in that boat. And you've been in that same boat for a long time, just like they were. And then all of a sudden, it's like that peace just starts to leave because you get tired. And that's when we can make decisions that aren't the best decisions. But Jesus said, my peace I leave with you. So I was thinking about a time when, oh my gosh, I had so many examples. I was up at 3:30 this morning. Unfortunately, and I was up close to almost about 6, it was like 6:20, and then I fell asleep. Well, that was great, because then I overslept, but anyway, and so then I was anxious, and I'm not supposed to be anxious, so I was getting ready, and I'm like, oh yeah, my peace, I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm not letting these dogs out, I got to make my bed, I did make my bed, just so you know. But I was thinking about all these different times in my life when I just did not operate in peace. How many of you done that? If anybody's ever gone through a situation where you're like, peace, and just toss him aside, pick him up when I feel good. You know, and it's true. It's awesome when you get a new job. You're like, you've been waiting for a new job. All of a sudden you're like, so much peace. Oh God, you're so amazing. Or, you know, when things are going your way, we have peace. That's not really peace. Do you understand that? That's just circumstance. And so when things aren't going our way is what God is saying, that in the midst of storms, do we hold our peace? Because he never said we would have the absence of storms. So I was thinking about one instance, and I know I've shared this before, but I have some other ones that are too close in proximity of time that I feel that I can't share right now, that I will wait on, because I went through one of the hardest seasons of my life over the last couple of years. And sometimes what robs our peace isn't something that you do, it's maybe what somebody else does. And our response to that is really important. It's how we respond in situations that's really important. So I was, this is many years ago, and it has to do with Matthew, but this is important that you hear this and that you hear that these things happen in life, because if our focus is always the absence of a storm, then we're never going to operate in the peace that Jesus said that he left us. So I get a call, and it was like late one night that Matthew had just, and you, I know you've heard the story, but for those of you who haven't, that Matthew was in a car accident, and that he had wrapped his car around a telephone pole going like 75 miles an hour, and he was high on drugs and drunk, and pretty much they thought he was left for dead at that moment because he was unresponsive at the scene. And I'm 6.5 hours away. And my first response is like, oh, are you kidding me? Like, I want to, like, respond in fear. And I can honestly tell you that I experienced, because I had to experience, I had 6.5 hour drive that I could have every kind of worst case scenario go through my head, or I could decide that I was going to tap into the peace that he left me and know that the Prince of Peace abides within me. That no matter what the circumstance or what the outcome was going to be, that I had to trust God. Because see, peace is grounded in the soil of trust. Right? That's how it grows. It grows in the soil of trust. In our fast-paced society, it's hard to form trust in God if we don't take time, because it takes relationship, because trust is formed through relationship. So we have to have a relationship with God. That's why, guys, all these, it's not just principles. This is cute, but these aren't just principles. It's not just a principle. It's the fact that he is the Prince of Peace. And when he said to me, and when he said to you, my peace I leave to you, my peace. And so when he's saying, I'm leaving you my peace, that means that he's saying, look, you're about to go through some stuff. You're going to need some peace. Your kids are going to do things that you never thought they would do, even though you've trained them up in the way they should go. My word is that when they grow old, they will not depart from it. I had to do the growing old part. I'm like, oh my gosh, this kid's going to kill me. Because I'm so tired of every phone call. He's been arrested. He's been this. He's been that. I thought, oh my lands, please deliver him soon or deliver me. So I get this phone call. So I have a 6.5 hour trip. And so I decided I'm going to tap into the Prince of Peace. And I got there, and I had heard that he sent pictures, that he just had, like, lashes on his face. He's got a scar still to this day on the back of his head. But that was it. The fact that he made it, they were like, that's amazing. That's a miracle. I know there was an angel in that car with him because God showed me. That was a miracle. It was a miracle. God had a call in his life. So I hadn't seen him yet. I got to the place where his car was, and my legs, like, lost their sensation and just, like, wanted to buckle down to my knees, because I thought, there's no way anybody walks out of a car that looks like that. It was demolished. And so I went. It was like I was the Doubting Thomas. I had to feel it just to make sure, is that real? So I felt it, and I was just like, I experienced what it was like to hold on to a promise of God, that he said to me, I will save your son just like I did my own. That was my promise. For years, when I would travel and I would do conferences and I would mission trips and I would go into some really like hard places, scary places, and I was never afraid because I was there representing Jesus. People need to know Jesus. And so when I would do that, and he would get lash after lash after lash after lash because the enemy would come against him, and I would say, oh, God, this is really worth it. I can go out and save the whole world and lose my own son. This doesn't make any sense to me. And he said, Kathy, I will save him just like I saved my own. That's all I needed. And I held on to that word till this day. Isn't that amazing? So God comes, and our response in the midst of storms is so important to keep our peace. Because let's just face it, what do we do when we get that phone call? Come on, if you get that phone call, what do you do if you get the yellow slip, or is it a green slip? I don't know. I've always been self-employed. What do you get? Green, pink? Pink. It's not green or yellow. It's pink. You get a pink slip. What do? How do you react? Are you listening to me? What happens when you just think that you just got your head above water and your finances are looking good and you're like, yeah, peace, and all of a sudden all this stuff explodes in your house and you've got all these bills and you're like, I just got above water. And do you understand? And so, but God is saying, are you gonna let go of the peace that I gave you? Or are you gonna keep the peace that I gave you and go and weather through the storm? You see, I love the example when the disciples were on the boat and the storm's coming and the wind and the waves, and Jesus comes and he's in the boat and he's asleep. He's sleeping. He's probably like, I can't remember how he's sleeping, by the way. I was like, I'd probably be like sick, like tossing. He's sleeping. And I love this. He's ye of little faith. And he rebukes them. He rebukes the wind and the wave, and it's calm. Bill Johnson says this, a storm you can sleep through is a storm you have authority over. Sure, he got a hand clap. I haven't got a hand clap yet. Let me pull out some of these here, just a second. Just kidding. Oh, here's one. Our perfect circumstances can't be what ignites a fire within us to be passionate about what the things of God are. Yeah, Bill. Bill who? I got my piece. He's cute. I better keep him up here a little more. Okay.
All right, we'll do this.
So, I lost my train of thought. I just got so much peace. Oh, circumstances. Okay, circumstances of life. So, well, we want a peaceful life. We want an empowering life. It's not the absence of circumstances. Do you guys get that? It's not the absence of circumstances. It's not the absence of adverse circumstances. Because he said that in this life, you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. What does that mean? That means that if we hook up with the Prince of Peace, you have to trust. This is the big issue, is that like a year ago, I didn't know if I was going to keep my house. I did not know if I was going to keep my house. And that was a big deal to me. I'm like, I don't know if I'm going to lose my home. And I thought, okay, now my mind, if I have a moment, but just don't make it a monument. And I had a moment. And I thought, I'm not going to build a monument out of this moment. And all of a sudden, I thought, okay, I'm not going to go there anymore. Because then fear comes in. Come on, fear and anxiety are the absence of peace. If you say, I'm so anxious, if you have an anxious, stressed out life like my dog, then you have to get peace. You have to find peace. You have to say, do you always see that glass half empty? What if it is half empty and it's not half full? What if everybody's wrong and everybody that's saying that is half full, it's really not, it's actually half empty? You ever think about that? It is. Okay, guess what, guys? It's half empty. It's okay if it's half empty. What happens if your life isn't as smooth sailing as you want it to be? If we're waiting for all of our circumstances to be good, if we're waiting for everything to be right, you're never going to really understand what it's like to operate with the Prince of Peace. There's nothing more empowering than when I'm around somebody who has such a level of trust in God that no matter what they're going through, they just know that, hey, whatever the outcome is, I'm not talking about taking it just a complacent role, but it's saying that whatever the outcome is, I know my God and I trust him. And I know that he will see me through no matter what trial I'm in the midst of, that he is still going to be there and he is still on the throne. That's the kind of peace that God wants us to operate in. It's not the absence of the storm. So there's things that we have to do to like say, okay, how do I operate in that? How do I get to that place? Well, guess what? There's going to be a trial up ahead. You're either in one or you're going to be going through one. That's just how it is. I used to think that, you know, I got saved and somewhere along, I don't know what I thought, but I thought when I got saved, that's it. It's all done. Now I just get to walk with all the lilies and the roses, and this is amazing. And it wasn't true. People were still mean. They were. And he still was driving me crazy. Still does. Now I'm going to get another one. Oh, my gosh. He already drives me crazy. So life still happens. The difference between us and the world is that we have peace. This isn't developed. This isn't developed hearing a message. This isn't developed through somebody's story. This is developed through you having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I hope you never get that phone call, but if you do, how do you respond? Do you freak out? Is your first reaction fear? Or is your first reaction going to be, okay, I need your peace. You said you gave it to me, not feeling it. I'm going to walk it out by faith because I trust you. Because here's the thing. I used to think that peace was a feeling. It's not a feeling. Peace is just the assurance of the fact that the things that I'm praying for, the things that I'm holding on to, the promise that God gave me is going to come to pass. That's what peace is. I've spent plenty of time freaking out in my life and being scared, being depressed, full of anxiety, and it never added anything to me. And I don't know if it's just you get older, you get wiser, you young people, get it right now. Because things are going to happen. Storms will always be there. A peaceful life is a powerful life. It's one of the most powerful things that you can have. Turn with me to Isaiah 26. I'm going to close with this. Let me read some definition of being anxious. People say, well, I'm not anxious. Do you worry? Do you experience worry? Are you uneased, nervous? Do you look at an event or something coming up with an uncertain outcome? Do you get concerned, apprehensive, fearful? Troubled, bothered, disturbed, distressed, disquieted, fretful, agitated. Ooh, I've been agitated before. I was just agitated this morning that my alarm went off. That's news. That's of the devil right there. Because I pushed that thing not good. Did you get on edge? You ever been around someone they're so on edge? They're like so intense, like my dog. But I love him because when he's calm and he sits on my lap and he just looks at me. Anyway, you have to love dogs to understand it. Because everybody else, they come around, they're like all hyper. And then they're like barking and going crazy and they're looking at you like, why would you have that dog? And I'm like, well, he's not like that all the time. And then when they leave, they're like this cute little furry, cuddly ball. And you're like, oh, see, they just don't see this. They don't see the other side of you. that don't understand. Anyway. Are you jumpy? There we go. Becca. I didn't even look up. I already knew what was happening. Do you have your stomach in knots? Then you are anxious. Isaiah 26, verse 3, says, "You will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts in you, because he trusts in you. Trust in the Lord forever. In Yah, the Lord, is everlasting strength." That word Yah is Jehovah. He is God. He always was and always will be. Where it says perfect peace, I look that up. Do you want to know what perfect means? Shalom. He said, I'll keep him in shalom, shalom. Peace, peace. I thought, why did he say that twice? I'll keep you in shalom, shalom. Peace, peace. Do you ever hold a baby? What do you do when they cry? Shh. That's not a good daddy. For all of you good parents out there. For you good daddies and good mommies. Or just anyone, you do this. And I think that's what God is saying. Shalom, shalom. It's okay. So if you keep your eyes fixed upon him, he'll keep you in what? Shalom, shalom. Because you trust in him. And it says that if you trust in him, in Yah, the Lord is everlasting strength. Can you put it up there for me, please? I'm missing a part. It says that he will sustain you. Trust in the Lord forever, for in Yah, for the Lord is everlasting strength. Go on, please. Go up. I'm missing something somewhere. Go up one more. Huh. You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed. Oh, stayed. That's the word, stayed. Okay, that word stayed literally means to be sustained. So this right here is what it's talking about. So if your mind is, this is sustained, this would not be able to be up here, right? It would be floating. Oh my gosh, Ahmad's like, oh my gosh, don't drop it. I love doing this. Right now he's like having a panic attack. Okay, keep peace. Keep peace. I'm putting this in your car. This is going to be your little buddy. Your prince of peace. Yes. So, for those who trust in God, who keep their eyes set upon him, he will sustain. He will be a strength. Someone you can lean on. Isn't that good? It's so good. God is so good. I was thinking about, I'm going to close with this, but I was thinking about, he spoke to me while I was preparing for this, and he said, you know, remember when I said to Joshua, be strong and be of good courage? For as I was with you, as I was with Moses, I will be with you. Do you think that was like encouraging? What did that say? This is through the having to have to part the Red Sea in the first place, having to have manna in the first place, having people come against your leadership, just get ready for that, they're going to murmur and complain. That's what Moses experienced. What's he saying? He said, I will be with you. Be strong, be courageous through the trials, through the fires, through the wind and through the waves. Be strong, be courageous. Keep the peace that God left you. Amen? Amen. Come on, give him glory. I had a couple of words. So Lisa, you've experienced, Gilbert and Lisa, you guys have experienced a lot of, hardship and things in your life. And God has developed within you an understanding of what it is like to have to go through these trials and things that you have faced with peace. And I feel like there's a reward that God wants to give you. And, you know, sometimes there's rewards that are stored up in heaven and we don't know what they're going to be until we get there. But I feel like God is going to bestow a reward upon you now. And I don't understand exactly what that is, but I felt like there was not just more than a recognition, but I felt like God is going to openly display his goodness in your life. So I feel like there's, maybe it's a financial blessing that's going to be unexpected that's going to come to you. I don't know. But I just feel like there's a reward that's coming your way. You've stood the test of time. And also when Rachel was singing earlier and I literally stood like in the midst of the glory saying, yes, Lord, that's me. You're going to refresh my youth and restore my youth. And because that's a prayer of mine is that I will always have vigor to run the race because I have a word from the Lord that I will live until I'm 102 and I will live at 102 just as vibrant as I did when I was 42. And so I believe that God is restoring to you like your youthfulness, that like your vitality to be able to continue to run. There's some dreams in your life that are they're dormant, and he's going to breathe a fresh breath of life on those dreams. And I just hear him say right now that it's not too late. It's not too late. It's not like a season has passed and it's like, oh, the season's passed. The season hasn't passed. The season is yet. The season is yet to be. And so, Father, I just bless them with that word. I thank you for a reward that is openly displayed for others to see. Because, God, that you are the one that is going to get the glory for it. I thank you for an awakening, a dream, a particular dream that's been in their heart. And that it almost felt as though that maybe it's dormant for a season. I don't know if they thought they would pick it back up. But now, Lord, I'm asking, awaken that dream right now within them. For it's not too late. And I thank you for restoring their youthfulness and restoring their vitality, that they're able to run the race and do what it is that you put within their hands and within their heart to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give God praise. Matthew and Rachel, I heard the Lord say that you are risk takers. And it's hard to just do for your own sons, but ever since Rachel chose to, I don't know, you guys, many of you don't know this, but she's quitting her job, her full-time job that she gets paid very well doing, to come and help us and not get paid but peanuts, to be our administrator here at the church. And she's doing it, it's because she's believed that, and Matthew as well, believe that God has called him to do that. And ever since then, everything that could come against that decision has happened. Like, again, like finances. Like, you know, it's like, oh, okay, we're in a financial place where we can do that. And I really believe that that's what God is trying to show you. He doesn't want you to do it because you're at a financial place where you can do that. And so it's going to look as though for a season that finances are going to deplete, but he's going to show you that you can trust him. You can trust him. And that, I know that's not the word that you want to hear, but it'll go back up. There will be a season, and that God's going to say that you can trust me. You can trust me. You can trust me. Because he's going to grow a level of faith in you that is going to command attention. It's going to command attention from the evil one. It's going to command attention for the demonic forces that try to come against what God's trying to do in this region. And Matthew, God's hand is upon you to be able to speak forth and declare life into families. I don't know if you know it, but God's going to use you to really bring restoration into families. You have a heart to see families restored. And it's going to take a level of faith and understanding of what it looks like to operate in places where it seemed as though it was dry, and yet God said, trust me, and you're going to have peace in the midst of it. And you're going to make decisions not based on what you see, but based on what you know and based on who you know. Amen? So give God praise. Yeah, stand to your feet if you would. God, you're so amazing. You're so amazing. Shalom, shalom. Shalom, shalom. God, coming from someone who's experienced a lot of trauma in life, it's hard sometimes to go into situations that look similar to former situations and walk with peace. But God, you will sustain those who keep their eyes upon you and keep them in shalom, shalom. And so today, God, I'm asking for an impartation for every person in this place, that they will not be those, Lord, who look for the absence of storms, but that, God, that they celebrate knowing that in the midst of a storm, they get to walk with you and they get to trust you. I also pray, God, that there would be a revelation that would come into the body of Christ and in this body right here in this place, that there's always enough time to put you first. And that if we establish our relationship with you, then we will trust that you will be with us through the hardest of times and through the best of times. You're always there. So I say shalom, shalom, peace, 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 peace. Be with every single person in this place. And you said that you left us your peace, your perfect peace. And I'm asking God that we don't put it down. So bless them today, God, with peace, to hold on to your promise. In Jesus' name, amen. Give God praise.